everyone. Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge of allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Welcome, everybody. Roll call.
Mr. Bell?
Here.
Mr. Kraus?
Here.
Mrs. Meany?
Here.
Mr. Mooney?
Here.
Mr. Filoni?
Here.
Ms. Richmond?
Here.
Mr. Russo?
Here.
Okay, we are going to have a change to the agenda. We are looking to add an additional item, which is a resolution in support of Congenital Heart Defect Awareness Week. I'm going to ask the mayor just to make a couple comments, and then we can entertain a motion to add it, as it will be agenda item number 6. Just make a couple comments, and then we'll make the motion to add it. Yeah.
Yes, this was a resolution. It was brought to my attention by a Solon resident that the week of February 7th through the 14th is known as Congenital Heart Defect Awareness Week. Congenital heart defects are most frequently occurring birth defect and a leading cause of birth defect-related deaths worldwide. Over 1 million families across America are facing the challenge of raising a child with congenital heart defects. Every year, approximately 40,000 babies are born in the United States with congenital heart defects, and some of these defects are not diagnosed until months or sometimes years after birth. So despite the statistics, newborns and young athletes are not routinely screened for congenital heart defects, and disproportionately a small amount of funding is available for this type of research. So this Awareness Week provides an opportunity for families whose lives have been affected to celebrate life and to remember loved ones lost, to honor dedicated health professionals, and to meet others and know that they are not alone. So the establishment of Congenital Heart Defects Awareness Week will also provide the opportunity to share the experience and information with the public and the media in order to raise public awareness about congenital heart defects. And so I am going to be asking the council to pass a resolution to proclaim the week of February 7th through the 14th to be Congenital Heart Defects Awareness Week, and encourage all citizens to increase awareness, education, and services for congenital heart defects, which affect thousands of babies every year. Thank you very much.
Okay. Councilman Bell?
Would like to make a motion to add this resolution to our February 4th, 2013 agenda this evening.
All right, and that will be under new, and it will be item number 6.
Yes, please.
Okay, second by Councilman Russo. Any further discussion? Roll call.
Mr. Bell?
Yes.
Mr. Kraus?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Mooney?
Yes.
Mr. Filoni?
Yes.
Ms. Richmond?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Okay, brings us to announcements. We do have a few. We have an Enterprise Zone meeting this Wednesday morning. The Public Works meeting will be as scheduled this week. The Safety Committee meeting will be as scheduled next week. City Hall will be closed on President's Day, and thus the next council meeting will be on Tuesday, the 19th. We do have budget hearings beginning on the 19th, so we have scheduled the council meeting at 8 o'clock instead of 7:30 to accommodate the budget hearings, and in all likelihood we'll probably have an abbreviated caucus that evening around 7:45. So that will be on the 19th. Okay, brings us to approval of minutes from our last council meeting.
Move to approve this minute.
Councilman Filunas, second by Councilman Russo. Any further discussion? Roll call.
Mr. Bell?
Yes.
Mr. Kraus?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Mooney?
Yes.
Mr. Filunas?
Yes.
Ms. Richmond?
Abstain.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Okay, brings us to comments from the audience. Any comments from the audience? Okay. Brings us to Planning Commission consent. Item 1.
An application was received for property located on Pettibone Road, permit parcels 956-1709-010 and 011. From Constance Masick and Joseph Ferenczi for lot split consolidation, which was approved by the Planning Commission.
Item 2.
An application was received from Uptown Solon LLC for Rusty Bucket, located at 6025 Cruzy Drive for a total number of wall signs, variance to permit 3, and the Planning Commission approved.
Okay. Do we have a motion, Councilwoman Richmond?
I would move to approve items number 1 and 2 from the Planning Commission under suspension.
Okay. Motion, second by Councilman Bell. Any further discussion? All right. Roll call under suspension.
Mr. Bell?
Yes.
Mr. Kraus?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Mooney?
Yes.
Mr. Palunis?
Yes.
Ms. Richmond?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes. Final passage.
Mr. Bell?
Yes.
Mr. Kraus?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Mooney?
Yes.
Mr. Palunis?
Yes.
Ms. Richmond?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Okay. Brings us to pending item 3.
Ordinance number 2012-280. An ordinance authorizing the mayor to enter into a collective bargaining agreement with the International Brotherhood of Teamsters Local 436 Building Inspectors for the period January 1st, 2013 through December 31st, 2015 and declaring an emergency. And this ordinance has had 3 readings.
Okay, we're going to keep this on 3 readings. Okay, brings us to the next part of our agenda, which is the annual meeting of the Solon Community Improvement Corporation Board of Trustees. And I'm going to turn it over to the mayor.
Thank you. At this time, I would like to convene the annual meeting of the Community Improvement Corporation. Roll call.
Mr. Bell?
Yes.
Mr. Kraus?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Mooney?
Yes.
Mr. Palunis?
Yes.
Ms. Richmond?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
This time, I would ask for a motion that's necessary to nominate the following officers of the Community Improvement Corporation. Executive Director will be me. The President will be me. It's always uncomfortable when I have to do this every year, it sounds. But Vice President, Vice Mayor Ed Kraus, Treasurer, Finance Director Dennis Kennedy, and Secretary Clerk of Council Carol McConaughey. So is there
moved.
A motion?
So moved.
Second?
Tony?
Yes.
Any discussion? Roll call.
Mr. Bell?
Yes.
Mr. Kraus?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Mooney?
Yes.
Mr. Palunis?
Yes.
Ms. Richmond?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Thank you for those nominations and the confirmation of appointments of the officers. Since there's no, just to give people a quick explanation again, the Community Improvement Corporation, it was established to assist in the financing of industrial and commercial expansion through the issuance of industrial revenue bonds. So it's not a practice the city uses often. We have used it in the past, but we haven't had the any reason recently to implement that. So at this time, I'll have a motion to adjourn the meeting of the CIC.
We need a motion to close the nominations and confirm the appointment.
And I just
the first
that?
Motion was to nominate.
To nominate.
Okay, I just thanked everybody for the motions. Okay, sincerity, thank you for your nomination.
Let's have a vote on
confirmation of appointment. I'd like to ask for a motion to close the nominations and confirm the appointments.
So moved.
Moved by Councilman Palunis, seconded by Councilwoman Meany. Roll call.
Mr. Bell?
Yes.
Mr. Kraus?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Mooney?
Yes.
Mr. Palunis?
Yes.
Ms. Richmond?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
And then I'll ask for a motion to adjourn the meeting of the CIC.
So moved.
Moved by Councilwoman Richmond, seconded by Councilman Bell. Roll call.
Mr. Bell?
Yes.
Mr. Kraus?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Mooney?
Yes.
Mr. Palunis?
Yes.
Ms. Richmond?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay, brings us back to the agenda and new item number 4.
Ordinance number 2013-11. An ordinance submitting to the electors the rezoning of various parcels totaling approximately 5.69 acres located on Aurora Road near the intersection of Aurora Road and Solon Road from the current C3 commercial zoning district to the C4 motor service commercial district and declaring an emergency. This is first reading.
Okay. We do have a public hearing this evening, so I will open the public hearing, and anyone interested in commenting on this ordinance to for the rezoning of the various parcels on Aurora from the current C3 commercial to C4 motor service commercial district. Anyone would like to speak regarding the public hearing? Come on up.
Thank you.
Jim Covington, Chairman of the Solon Chamber of Commerce. To this Solon City Council, the Board of Directors of the Solon Chamber of Commerce supports the rezoning of the Liberty Ford property at 32811 and 32915 Aurora Road from C3 to C4. That will allow the redevelopment of the dealership. The chamber encourages the placement of the issue on the May ballot for the voter approval. Redevelopment of the Liberty Ford Auto Group dealership will improve the aesthetics of Aurora Road by removing the empty buildings and updating the current dealership property. Redevelopment will also serve as a catalyst for other redevelopment in the area. The mission of the Solon Chamber is to serve as advocates for the business community by supporting and fostering vibrant economic growth. Thank you.
Thank you. You could submit it to the clerk. Sure, absolutely. Thank you. Any further comments? Come on up.
I need a stool. Good evening. My name is Geraldine Habishaw. I live at 32900 Aurora Road. I'm the president of the Solon Park Estates Condominiums, which is directly across the street from the Ford dealer. I appreciate that growth has to go on and things have to be done, but I think you have to look at the residents that are currently living there. There are 32 of them, and then there's the house on the next side of us. I have a prepared statement that I'd like to read. I'm here in response to a notice of public hearing sent to the unit owners regarding a request to change zoning for 32915 Aurora Road from the current C3 to C4 zoning. I've had my residence at this address for 23 years, and in that time I've found that some progress and growth is not always good, especially when it is at the expense of your neighbors. For 23 years have fought to stop tractor trailers filled with cars from being delivered at 3 and 4 a.m., dropping heavy chains and dropping steel ramps on the ground. The giant rubbish bins being emptied and banged at 5 a.m. with noise loud enough to wake the dead. The glaring lights that pour into our windows. In the springtime and summer, the noise from the car wash and the blaring of their public address system gives no peace and quiet to enjoy the outdoors. We did get some relief when Chief Godges would notify every time they delivered, and I had to call. I'd be up at 3 or 4 in the morning saying the cars are being delivered, and I hated doing that because every time you do that, you're calling the police from maybe some emergency. I felt guilty about it. It was always on again, off again. When Chief Gazitz retired and Chief Vineland became chief, it started all over again. We'd get this lull and nothing would be delivered, and then it started all over again. I went through the weekly calls to the police department, and thankfully Chief Vineland got it stopped, the delivery of the cars. The bins are still happening. They come and they bang them at 5 a.m. They don't care what's happening. I don't believe that residents should have to do this. Laws are in place to protect us. And making residents call every time there is a problem, you make the victim become the villain. The delivery of cars, parts, and services, trucks idling, and air brakes going off must be stopped. And the chief has done a wonderful job. I really appreciate everything that you've done for me, Chief. I appreciate it. Who here would like this to happen where you live? I have no idea what more could happen if the change to zoning board happens. We can't stand any more intrusions on our lives. What will happen to the values of our properties too? How many cars is too many? 200, 1,000, 2,000? When does it stop? When does the consideration start? When does the almighty dollar give way to the people? Protection must be put in place to protect us. What does motor service commercial zoning district mean? I don't know yet. I haven't had a chance to read up on everything, but I will find out what it means. What will happen to the noise level? If this is what we had before this changes, what's going to happen after it changes? I'm asking all concerned to very carefully examine all the consequences of changing this zoning and how it may affect the residents. It's in your hands. How are you going to protect us? Do you have any questions for me?
Anybody have any questions?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any further comments regarding the item four on the public hearing? Any further comments? Yeah.
I have a question.
Sure.
What parcel?
Why don't you come on up and just state your name and your address? And
hi, my name is Jim Aleshi. We have a abutting property.
What's your address?
32910 Solon Road.
Okay.
And I was just wondering, it said various, and in our letter that we received, the various parcels are what parcels exactly? Do they abut to our property, or are they?
Rob, do you want to?
Yeah, I can show you.
Thanks.
Okay. I just didn't have that.
Yeah, I'll put it up here so you've asked the question so everybody can see it.
Okay.
Just, this is the Aurora Road, Solon Road.
Mm-hmm.
Here's the police.
Why don't you wait for the camera? Okay, it's camera's on.
No, I'm sorry, I didn't look. Yep.
Okay, it includes these properties.
Yeah, just the parcels in blue in the police station's here, and I believe your building is
over. No, our building's right.
Oh, this one then?
No, our building's right.
So
yeah, see, that was concerned about those two right there.
Rob, could you orient us? There's a lot of people watching.
Yeah, I did orient off camera.
Okay.
Aurora Road, Solon Road, and this is the existing dealership building. The addition would take off. The proposed alteration would remove this front part of the building, and then thanks, Rick. And then would make the addition over to about here, about a little more than doubling the size of the building. And for other orientation, this is the police station here. And it's about 5.64 acres. The site plan, just to show what they're proposing near your property, Jim, would be. This is the site plan. So this, yeah, this property. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So there will be parking in that corner there.
Yeah. All right. Okay. Well, I wasn't prepared for this. I received a letter like last week or so. And, I just wanted to find out what that
sure,
was.
Sure.
There are two lots that do affect us. And, if there would be some growth in, I wouldn't see a problem with probably 95% of this this plan. As a matter of fact, it would probably be a great plan. But there are a couple lots that are abut our property that would be crucial to our growth mm-hmm. and our future situation, which we're planning on relocating our store. And we appreciate that consideration.
Sure, sure.
Okay, probably.
Yeah, parking would be there.
Yeah, parking. So.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Hey, Rob, before you leave, there was a comment regarding, what sort of, you don't have to give the whole definition of what the change in the zoning to C4
right.
from the C3.
Right. Of course, it's currently zoned C3.
Right.
What C3 says is that any and all retail uses are allowed. The difference between C3 and C4 is that C4 is much more restrictive than C3.
Yeah.
But there is one difference, though, that it does not allow for general, C4 does not allow for general retail. It allows for automotive, allows for hotels, allows for sit-down restaurants, allows for fast food restaurants, and the one wild card is allows for gas stations. But it's the only district that allows for automobile sales, so that is, that's why they're asking for it.
And the C3 is open-ended.
Yeah, except for the law directors going way back have ruled that it doesn't permit automobile sales.
Okay. And thus, for the rezoning, the request for the rezoning to C4.
Correct. To make that, that's necessary to make the dealership, the current dealership, conforming, and to allow them to tear down the office building that's to the east of the dealership and expand.
Okay. Any further comments on the public hearing?
I just have a question for Rob. And I just want to clarify, the change in zoning does not in any way, shape, or form change any of the existing noise ordinances. Whatever exists now is not going to change just because of the zoning change.
That's true. And also, if the zoning zone change is approved, a site plan will come before this body. And if you feel that other conditions are necessary, you can certainly impose more conditions on the development.
He bought it. Anything further? Okay. Thanks, Rob. I appreciate it. All right. Anything further? Any further public comments regarding agenda item number four? Okay. Thank you for the comments. I appreciate it. This will close the public hearing, bring it back to the table. There is an emergency on the ordinance as a result of the time constraints that we have. Regarding if we want to get this to the May ballot. Obviously, it's already February, so there are specific time constraints. Rob, when does this need to move regarding the May ballot?
According to the clerk's office, it's by May 4th. It's got to be sent to the board. Your May 4th meeting, you had to send it to the Board of Election.
March.
Yeah, couldn't be May.
March, yeah. Okay.
March.
Okay, so there is a little bit of time, but... that's why we have it on as an emergency tonight, just because of the time constraint. So, yeah, well, Mayor.
I just wanted to make a comment to Ms. Happy Shaw and also Mr. Alessi. Although it's going to be the council's, looks like they're going to pass it to so that it gets to the ballot, the whole idea is, and we appreciate your comments, as Mr. Franklin stated, when it then comes forward, should the zoning pass, when it comes with a site plan, then that's when we need to take the concerns of surrounding neighbors, we do take those seriously. We've done that in the past. We just did it with the Echo Development, with the Market District, and right next to Carrington, with the senior living, and we had some conditions placed over there because of some noise concerns and lighting concerns and things such as that. So that is when, just because it'll go to the ballot, and from the city's position, I do hope this does get rezoned. I do think it'll be beneficial, but that doesn't mean that doesn't leave time to address your concerns. So I don't want, those are two separate issues, so I don't want you to think you came here and nobody listened and they're going to pass it on. But that's why we have to have these ongoing discussions, and when they do bring a site plan, it'll be going to planning, to the different committees, and then ultimately back to council. Those are the stages where we take the concerns from surrounding neighbors and however we can come to a compromise so that everybody, it's something that everyone can live with. That's what we work towards at that time. Okay, thank you.
Okay, what's the pleasure of everyone up here? You want to, ready to move it on?
I am, yeah.
Sure.
Okay, any further comments? Okay, well, why don't we, is there a motion? Councilman Mooney?
I'll make a motion to approve item four, submitting to the electors the rezoning of the various parcels on Aurora Road from C3 commercial zoning to C4 motor service.
And declaring an emergency.
And declaring an emergency.
Under suspension.
Under suspension.
Okay. A motion by Councilman Mooney, second by Councilwoman Meany. Any further discussion? Okay. Roll call under suspension.
Mr. Bell?
Yes.
Mr. Crouch?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Mooney?
Yes.
Lunas?
Yes.
Ms. Richmond?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Final passage.
Mr. Bell?
Yes.
Mr. Krause?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Mooney?
Yes.
Mr. Palunas?
Yes.
Ms. Richmond?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Okay. Item five.
Ordinance number 2013-12, and ordinance authorizing payment on an as-needed basis to Signal Service for traffic signal repair services for the year 2013.
Bill Mooney.
Signal Services has done our traffic signal repair and maintenance for several years now. Although we're going to be replacing all of our signals over the next 2 years, we still have to keep the existing lights functioning until they do get replaced. This is on an as-needed basis up to a total of $48,000. So I'd make a motion to pass this under suspension.
Motion by Councilman Mooney, second by Councilman Russo. Any further discussion? Okay, roll call under suspension.
Mr. Mr. Bell?
Yes.
Mr. Kraus?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Mooney?
Yes.
Mr. Palunis?
Yes.
Ms. Richmond?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Final passage.
Mr. Bell?
Yes.
Mr. Kraus?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Mooney?
Yes.
Mr. Palunis?
Yes.
Ms. Richmond?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Okay, brings us to the end of our agenda.
Item six.
Oh, thank you. We do have item six.
Right. Resolution number 2013-13, a resolution in support of Congenital Heart Defect Awareness Week.
Any discussion from the table?
Just again, I would just like to thank Holly Boykin, who's the resident who brought forward this recognition of the serious heart, the serious health issue, and thank council for considering it.
Okay. Councilman Bell?
I'll make a motion to pass item number six, resolution in support of Congenital Heart Defect Awareness Week under suspension, as read by the mayor.
By Councilman Bell, second by Councilwoman Meany. Roll call under suspension.
Mr. Bell?
Yes.
Mr. Kraus?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Mooney?
Yes.
Mr. Palunis?
Yes.
Ms. Richmond?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Final passage.
Mr. Bell?
Yes.
Mr. Kraus?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Mooney?
Yes.
Mr. Palunis?
Yes.
Ms. Richmond?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Now brings us to the end of our agenda. Okay, we have comments from the audience. Any comments from the audience?
Okay. Adam Fair, 5846 Briar Hill. Not sure where to begin, but I was here before this council, I don't know, 4 to 6 weeks ago roughly, to talk about a couple, or one very specific safety hazard as it relates to the Briar Hill project, specifically the outlet stilling basin. And at that time, I showed a picture of the condition. I hope that the camera can pick this up off my phone. But today, the condition, there you go, that works. Today, the basin is still full of water. The only difference today is it's covered with a couple inches of snow and ice, creating, even in my opinion, even a greater safety risk. Now, one other issue has come to the forefront, which I felt had to come to the council's attention tonight because, again, of a safety issue. I've had conversations with the law director, our councilman Ed Kraus on this issue, and just felt that it had to come to this body tonight. And in doing that research, I came across an email dated October 26 from URS to Dan Driscoll and a list of other people. But in this email, not only is the other issue I want to talk about tonight discussed, but in this email, URS specifically recommend that the city drain the outlet stilling basin to determine how long it would take to fill up before researching additional solutions. That was in October. In December-ish, I came forward and talked about this. Today it's February 4th, and it's a bigger safety hazard today than it was when I was here 6 weeks ago. Again, just for clarity, when you take a look at that, you've got 12-foot concrete walls on the side, a child looking at 30 feet of fresh snow. It's an invitation to come in and play. Below that is 3 feet of freezing ice with 3 feet of rock below that, and no way to get out unless they can manage to get back to the, where they may have fell in. Now, unless they walk into this area, and then God knows what can happen. This can't continue. And again, in the email in October from URS to the city building manager, the recommendation was to drain it, and it hasn't happened. And then as of last week, another frightening issue has come to the forefront. Without a long, involved, detailed explanation, part of this project requires a storage building of equipment. This equipment contains all the controls that manipulate the gate that keeps the water at bay. Some of you are more familiar than others, but many of you are very familiar with what I'm talking about here. That building, next to that building, is a pad that sits a generator. A generator that is, in our opinion, in URS's opinion, when the project was completed, not even necessary. It's the third or fourth line of redundancy to operate the equipment in the building. However, at the end of the day,
The city required that the generator be there. We said, fine, have a generator. At a walkthrough on the site several months ago, I believe the law director was there. I believe John Bush and Dan Driscoll were there. There were a bunch of people there. I asked the question, what's going to power that generator? It's a $9,000 generator that's sitting there, and there was no power. At that time, no power source for it. A review of the plans didn't include a power source. So they started looking into how do we power the generator. The solution that was recommended was propane tanks, which we had reservations about propane tanks being used in a residential neighborhood to power a generator that arguably isn't even needed. But what we said is, as long as it's safe, it's secure, nobody can get into it, fine, put the propane tanks in. On the email in October that referenced the notes to drain the basin, there's additional comments specifically talking about the propane, including costs and some other things. It's a couple hundred bucks to install, and that wasn't the issue. But this, what they continued to say is, URS recommends the tanks be placed on a standalone pad using either cement, brick, pavers, or plastic. In addition, for security purpose, be placed in a locked enclosure with slats allowing for proper airflow. This is what was installed last week. There are two propane tanks that sit about 6 inches from the generator. They have about 1 inch, maybe 2 inches, from where the propane tank.
Can you zoom in on that, please? I can't.
Oh. Thanks. This one's standing upright. This one has been knocked off the pad. I don't know how or why. If it was a deer or kids playing there, I have no idea. But this one standing up, you can see there's approximately, well, you can see this wood stake, that's in the ground. Next to the wood stake is where the pad sits. The pad was designed for the generator. The pad wasn't designed for the power source. There was no power source planned when they built it. But in the city's infinite wisdom, they placed the two propane tanks, butted it up to the generator, an inch or two from the end of the slab, and one of them has been dislodged or moved, and it's now hanging off of the pad. You can actually see the copper wire that feeds it is bent. It just defies logic that the city would require GetGo to keep their propane in a locked brick enclosure. I drove all around Solon. Anybody that has propane, they're in locked, enclosed containers that they sit in. I'm told that there's no code that requires these be in a container. My response to the law director and Mr. Krause and anyone that would listen to me was, well, if the city doesn't have a code that this be closed in a safe manner, Briar Hill has a code that they should be placed in a safe manner. Folks, this is 40 yards from a recreational lake that kids play in all summer. This is 40 yards from the back of a property of a resident, maybe 60 yards from his house where kids play in. To the other side, I think to the east, is a field that has been created as part of this project where the lake dredgings were stored. Part of the project, they cleared a couple, I don't know how many hundreds of feet, but basically a football field or more of trees. The dredgings were placed there, dug up, ground up, and grass planted. That's going to be a field kids go in and play in this summer, I assure you. To get to that field, they have to pass these propane tanks. It's an invitation for disaster. I asked, with no uncertain conditions, the law director last week, do not allow these tanks to be put in. I called them after they were installed, which, by the way, when they first were installed, they were between the building and the generator, about a foot and a half. Apparently, were then moved a day or so later because, as I understand, the fire code is they'd be at least 5 feet from the building. They may be 5 feet from the building now, but they're certainly not safe. It's a bomb in our backyard. They need to be removed before somebody gets hurt. Our opinion is, if you want the generator and you insist that it be there, we're fine with it. Put a fence around it, put a lock on it, put a cover on it. Quite frankly, if you walk back there today, it's probably covered with snow. If there were an emergency in a snowstorm, you won't be able to find them to do anything with it. We have been treated specific to this subject like second-class citizens. I've reached out to anybody that would listen. I've had a couple phone calls to the mayor's office with no return phone call. Yes, I did a month and a half ago. I've spoke very specifically with the law director. Nobody seems to care. There was actually a comment last week where the law director asked one of the councilmen and said, well, if we fix this and put it in a proper manner with some of these unresolved issues, be dropped. Okay. No. The safety of our kids is not a negotiable standpoint here for on contracts. So these are other issues that need to get worked out, and they hopefully will get worked out in one way or another. This is an absolute insult. I don't believe anybody on this board and this council would allow propane tanks to be installed at the city park without them being enclosed and protected. It just doesn't make any sense to me. So I'm asking, I'm demanding that these tanks be removed. This is in progress, an unfinished construction site. We now have a frozen lake posing as a outlet stilling basin, which has been continued to be ignored. And now we have this sitting in our backyard. This needs to be removed, the propane tanks. The basin needs to be drained. We can continue to talk about all these other issues, but we have people at risk here. I have nothing else to say. I'll be happy to answer any questions, but.
Anything? Okay.
Thank you.
Good.
Okay, any further public comment? Any further public comment? Okay, bring it back to the table. Bob.
I have no comments this evening.
Nancy.
I just want to commend Tom and his crew and the fire and police. I mean, in these difficult conditions, they've just done a great job. I just want to say thanks.
Tony.
I have no comments tonight.
Rick.
No comments.
If you want.
Bill.
I'm sorry, what am I saying yes to?
Whatever you want to.
Oh, this is...
It's open. It's called open mic.
I will pass tonight.
Yeah.
Chief, does the police department have an event coming up in February?
16th.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Russo. On February the 16th, we have a reverse raffle hosted by the Solon Italian Club Foundation.
And what's the money going to be raised for?
Yeah, we're raising money for three separate programs at the police department, K-9 Fund, the DARE Fund, as well as the Patrolman's Benevolent Association.
Okay, and tickets are how much?
Tickets are $40 a piece. That buys you a shot at a $2,000 prize, plus dinner, beer, and wash for the evening.
Great. Well, I definitely will take two tickets myself, and I would ask the rest of my colleagues to at least do the same. Thank you.
Mine were purchased a week ago, just okay. So you know.
All right, just a couple comments. I know Mr. Fair indicated some of the concerns of Briar Hill, and he did make the comment that no one seems to be concerned about it, and I would say that there are people concerned about it. However you feel about it, everyone's concerned about it. So. I continue to have many discussions with them. I know that he's had many discussions with Mr. Lobey. There are obviously a lot of ongoing discussions. There is a lot of ongoing concerns. So both the city, the council, the law director, everyone is, you know, concerned about it. And it still is an open construction site. And there are unresolved issues. So there are a lot of people that are concerned about it to make sure that the project gets done. It was, for those that don't know the history, it was a long, drawn out, but in the end of the day, it was a great example of a, and not many communities can pull this off, of a public-private partnership. So that from the city standpoint, so we can ensure the overall stormwater management of our community, 23.9 acre feet of storage that we're going to get, and we've had for about 40 years from that lake. So just so everyone knows the history, there may be some squabbling going on now, but the project it was an unprecedented public-private partnership to make sure and to ensure that the city has and will continue to have a stormwater capability, stormwater management for many, many years to come. And if anyone was around June 22nd of 2006, you know how hard we've worked since then to make sure that our system, our city, the millions of dollars that we've spent to protect all the valuable assets that we have are probably our number one priority in this community. So I just wanted to make a comment to that. And just an additional comment, I did have a chance to talk to Tom this afternoon. And I first of all, I want to thank him for, I did get a call over the weekend from a resident from Spatterdock regarding the conditions on the street. And I did, as I've, in history, and Tom does such a great job of explaining how we go about the protection of our main roads and then within the subdivisions and then the streets that actually lead out to the main roads and the various priorities that we have throughout the city. And Tom did speak to a resident on Spatterdock today, or returned a call from a resident on Spatterdock today. And we had a lot of snow over the weekend, and I echo the comments that were indicated of the great work that the service department does. Weekends are not the easiest, and we had a lot of snow, I think, for starting from Friday, probably throughout the whole weekend, that we had ongoing snow, and the service department did a great job of clearing the main roads first and foremost, but also getting to the secondary roads and clearing those roads that go out to the main road. So I want to thank Tom, and if, I don't know, if, you know, when we get to you, if you just want to make just a general comment about how we do it, but we continue to do a great job during the difficult times and the difficult weekends like we've had. So thank you. That's my comments. Now comments from the administration, starting with the mayor.
Thank you. Just to let everyone know, the city has been working with the school administration addressing the school safety issues. We recently had a meeting, the administration with school, the school superintendent Joe Regano and chairman of safety Bill Russo attended as well. Tonight, the Solon Schools hosted a parent and community night to discuss safety issues, and obviously due to the conflict of the council meeting, no one from the administration or the city council could attend that meeting. So I wanted to, they're making an announcement at that meeting as well. I don't want anyone to look at that and say, where was City Hall for this meeting? We do take, we are very big supporters of the school, everybody up on this dais, as well as the city administration, and we will all continue working closely with the schools to implement the best practices and responses regarding school safety. But obviously we had a conflict with our two meetings, so we couldn't be there to show our support, but we do indeed give our full support to the schools and we'll work with them. Secondly, on January 26th, I had the honor of attending the 5th annual Solon Speech and Debate Tournament hosted at Solon High School this year. They also gave me the privilege of handing out the first place trophy, so that's always nice because everyone's glad to see you. You're standing there with a big trophy for them. I had the opportunity to watch the final rounds of original oratory, so I'd like to say congratulations to the Solon Speech and Debate Team President, Elizabeth Eder, who took first place in that category. I'd also like to congratulate the entire Solon Speech and Debate Team who took first place for the overall school scores. So that was quite an honor, great talent there, and it really is an exciting tournament. There was over 500 students. They're basically giving speeches and debating all day long, but the talent is really incredible. So congratulations to all. And finally, I'd like to say congratulations to our Sergeant Jamie Hoffman, who was nominated and awarded an award of commendation for exceptional service this week. His work throughout 2012 was recognized with his involvement in the Cuyahoga County OVI Task Force. His hours volunteered in his effort and dedication earned the Solon Police Department several honors last month at an award ceremony. The department was awarded by the county for checkpoint productivity, which is the number of contacts in the OVI checkpoints, exemplary service to the task force, best drive sober or get pulled over promotion, and best overall traffic safety media. This is something that Sergeant Hoffman has really taken a hold of and made successful. These awards included that we were given by the county a new portable breath testing device, numerous reflective vests and cones, a portable stop sign, and other safety gear. So just to say congratulations to Sergeant Hoffman. This is a fine example of an officer going above and beyond for the community that he serves. So congratulations to him. And that completes my comments tonight.
Okay, Tom?
Yeah, I'd like to supplement just a little bit with what Mr. Krause said. If there's an impression from Briar Hill that we have been non-compassionate, non-communicative, I really want to just clear that record up a little bit. We have dialogued, I've dialogued on this matter, but this goes back to a 2009 contract. If there's any implication that this administration or this mayor is not at least listening and trying to act, I would disagree with him. I do like his passion, but so everybody knows, we have met at City Hall in the last 6 months numerous times over this issue, with contractors, without contractors, with the design experts, with the construction people. We have talked about multiple issues. We've had hour-long telephone conversations to dialogue these matters. We have supplemented all of these documents. In fact, Mr. Driscoll even gave an outline of the issues that went on for 4 or 5 pages that we have provided to them. We have given them access to Mr. Frenzy, who was the design individual. We met at the site with Mr. Frenzy. We met at the site with the contractor. We met with Frenzy and the contractor and various council people at City Hall and at the site on numerous occasions. We have had this week alone probably 4 or 5 telephone conversations with Mr. Fair and other representatives. We've met at the engineer's office. We've met in the caucus room. Council has been advised, and this is an ongoing process, and we're towards the end of it, and there's some issues. We have recently enacted and even gone back to ODNR through Mr. Driscoll and Mr. Bush to see if any of these issues can be re-reviewed. We've gone back to the fire department on an issue of safety. So I do appreciate Mr. Fair's statements, but I want to make it crystal clear that this administration and this council have listened to these things, have reviewed them, have asked all the right questions, et cetera. And for example, like this mayor has never said, please do not use the engineer's resources to at least continue the dialogue. So do we have still disagreements? The answer is yes, but has there been a continuation of dialogue? In fact, I just had a dialogue even today with Mr. Krause, even on these particular points, and we continue the dialogue on it. So that I just want to make for the general public that we're not just not considering it, we are looking at it. Thank you.
Thanks, Tom. Carol?
I have no comment.
Chief?
First, thank you to the mayor for recognizing Sergeant Hoffman in public. I appreciate that. And also thank you to council for your continued support. And I'd also like to thank Mrs. Habishaw for her kind comments and to give her to reiterate what the mayor said. At the point in time where this comes back before planning, that is the point where we will have the opportunity to have input as to violations and lights and noise and make our recommendations in support of you with the contractor and the developer of those parcels. So,
thanks. Chief?
No comments, thank you.
Dennis?
No comments.
Rob?
No comments.
Tom?
No comments tonight.
I know I can count on Bandiera.
I'll make a brief comment to some of the concerns with some of the residential streets, but kind of in summary, and I would be glad to sit with any resident at any time and kind of go over the service department's operation plan when it comes to snow and ice removal. But we break the city into 3 zones. We're going to hit the mains and the state routes first. From there, we're going to go to the industrial routes, and we're going to go to a route called subdivisions that have significant hills and curves in it. We're going to prioritize those areas because we've recognized that they have hills, considerable curves, or entranceways where they're coming out onto main drags. And then finally, we're going to go into the secondary routes, secondary residential routes. So it does take a little bit longer for those areas to get cleaned up in a snowfall, especially when we're getting around 1 inch an hour like we've received recently. It's been a concern of some of the residents that have said that they have seen some of the streets maybe right next to the residential streets that look like they have more attention than the residential secondary streets. And the reason for that is we've identified some of these areas as main thoroughfares in particular subdivisions like Ada, Silkwood, Cromwell, White Oak, Chagrin Highlands Drive, just to mention a few that come to my mind. But the reason that we've prioritized these onto a secondary route, even though they're residential subdivision routes, is because of the amount of traffic that may travel those areas to a main route or a secondary route. So we've incorporated those in with these secondary routes to give them a little bit more attention so that we can get traffic moving out of those subdivision areas to those main thoroughfares and get them to the main routes and try to get them through our town as quickly as possible. So it does take us a little bit longer to get to the residential routes. We understand that, and we just ask, you know, to be as patient as possible. We will get there, get them plowed, and get them salted as quickly as possible. And like I said, I'd be glad to sit with anybody and go over our
operations plan with any resident that may have some concerns.
Thanks, Tom. Appreciate the comment. John?
No comments this evening.
Peggy? All right. Brings us to the end of our agenda. I think we're done with executive session. Is that correct, Mr. Law Director?
Yes.
Okay. So I think we have a motion to adjourn. Councilman
I'll
Bell?
I'll make that motion.
Mr. Poulounis, roll call.
Mr. Bell?
Yes.
Mr. Krause?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Mooney?
Yes.
Mr. Poulounis?
Yes.
Ms. Ritchie?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?